Let's do it. Hey, yeah. All right. Yeah. You think you're tough? Let's get some sand. Ah, you can't move. You yeah, I go with through. It. I go with it. Everything's like.
What's going on, everybody? Tommy from Fight Camp here, and in any second, one of the greatest of all time. Mike Tyson is gonna come walking through that front door. We're gonna be able to talk to him about boxing, fitness, and all things Fight Camp. Can't wait for it. I wanted to just start out talking about the concept of self-improvement. So this concept of like you versus you is something that's really big in the Fight Camp product. Somebody could take a workout, and they'll have a certain score from that workout, how many punches they threw, how hard they hit, how hard they worked, and then they can come back at a later date and take the exact same drill or the exact same workout. So if they're training to get in better shape, they can go up against that former version of themselves and see if they can beat that version of themselves.
I think everyone does that when they train, try to overcome their first achievement, beat the record. Subconsciously, I think everyone does that. It's never physically probably, huh?
Yeah. So with that concept of self-improvement, is that something that's always been something that you focused on?
Perfection is so complex that if you're not good enough, you're beneath it. And if you surpass it, you're too high. It's just, you just can't win with that perfection game. It's just, when you're hot, you're hot. Yeah. That's how it goes.
Yeah, for sure. Would you say that throughout your career, definitely from when you were a kid to when you first turned professional to when you were at your peak, you definitely just got better and better over time?
That comes from repetition. It's constantly doing it over and over and over again. You can do it in your sleep, and it's just, that helps you become better, I believe. And basically the same thing from the first day today you become champion. It's just the same basics, mm-hmm. with more intensity, more desire, more will as time goes by. Mm-hmm. You have to have a goal that's worth dying for. If you don't have a goal that's worth dying for, what the hell you want to do it anyway?
Mm-hmm. You were pretty passionate when you were competing, would you say?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
What motivated you back then when you were competing and you're on top of the world in boxing?
I don't know, I wanted to be like my heroes I read about. You know, Benny Lennon, Muhammad Ali, all those guys, Henry Armstrong, Roberto Duran. I just wanted to be like them. And I knew, when I read the book, I knew when they retired, they were broke and alcoholics, but I just wanted to be in that fraternity. I don't know why.
Yeah, some of those guys, when they're at their best, they were just unbeatable.
Forget them.
Who was your favorite fighter of all time?
Ali, probably. Him, Roberto Duran. It was quite a few, but those are like the top guys. Mm-hmm. Sugar Ray Leonard. Amazing. Golly. Yeah. Brunel Whitaker was awesome. Meldrick Taylor. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of great. Oh, Cesar Chavez. Julio Chavez. Forget it, man. Forget it. I mean, real fighters.
Yeah. He was always ready to fight.
To the end. Yeah. Exciting, too. Nothing boring about them.
Yeah. Ali, what do you think it was about Ali that made him great?
Self-confidence. Yeah. Self-confidence.
Yeah, it's important.
Self-belief. Mm-hmm. Determination. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Skill, brains, and guts.
Definitely self-confidence. You can see that with everything he said, the way that he did.
No, absolutely. Confidence breeds success. Success breeds confidence. It goes hand in hand.
You said confidence breeds success, and success breeds confidence. Yeah. that's interesting. Yeah, with Ali, I like to say, like, what makes an athlete or a fighter great is not necessarily just how good they are at the sport, right? But with Ali, he's one of those people that was just a crossover star for so many reasons.
Well, greatness is when you make your delusions your reality.
Okay.
You know, something that's just totally unbelievable to the human's imagination, mm-hmm. and you make it your slave.
When you make your delusions your reality, all right?
Nothing's impossible for somebody who's gonna try. Mm-hmm. If you're gonna try, it's capable of being done. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Would you say that's something that you did? You made your delusions your reality?
100%. Because nobody's supposed to live this crazy life. Still be living this, 100%, yeah.
You're still doing it, huh?
Yeah, there's no doubt about it, yes.
Maybe more than ever in some ways, right?
It's just where life takes you. Mm-hmm. You're not navigating it yourself. You may believe so, but you're not navigating your life.
Yeah. So when we talk about motivation, if you're gonna make your delusions your reality, that takes an extreme amount of grit and motivation, right? So what motivated you back then when you were younger and you're fighting?
Just to be in that fraternity with those guys. Yeah. It's just what I wanted to do. I want those guys to know my name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then what motivates you now?
Just succeeding, reaching my highest me I can be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want to see what's my greatest potential.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you reach a lot of people now in a different way. Would you say that it's a goal to inspire people or to help people learn or?
I don't know. It's just you could look at me as an anti-hero. So you can learn what not to do to be successful. You know, I don't look at myself as giving the world roses and flowers. I don't, that's not who I am. My life is created with a bunch of thorns.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If I could speak for myself, I could say I really appreciate, at the very least, that you make people think. Right? So I've listened to your podcast a little bit.
Thank you.
Yeah, it makes me think. So I appreciate that. I wanted to move on to this idea of tracking progress. So the Fight Camp punch trackers, they're a big part of the product. How important was tracking or benchmarking to you when you were training? Did you track things like, you know, how many miles you ran?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I knew without, if I did this, this was 3 miles, this was 5 miles. So I do the 3 miles. If I could do the 3 miles in like, what, 15 minutes, then I'm hot. You know what I mean? If I can do 5-minute miles, then I'm on the ball. And that's what I ran for. I ran for speed.
Mm-hmm.
How fast can I do 4 miles? How fast can I do 7 miles?
Yeah, and you knew if you were getting in that same one, that, you know, 6-minute mile, then a 5-minute, 50-second mile, that's how you were getting better?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Throughout the course of a camp.
Yeah, so you no doubt about it.
Would you start a camp and you'd feel like maybe you weren't going that fast, but as the camp went on?
No, as the camp go on, you become better. Then when you become better, you push yourself more. You push yourself when sometimes you have to submit to yourself. Mm-hmm. You just have to push yourself. You know, and not to kill yourself, you can tell when it's too much, but sometimes you gotta push yourself. I say to myself when I was younger, and I may have done 5 miles today, right? But I could have done 10. Mm-hmm. And I said, wow, God gave you all this and it's all you got to give back.
Mm-hmm.
5 miles, and that was my motivation.
Okay. Would you go into one of these runs knowing what you did last time for time or knowing what your best time was?
Oh, every day we did time. How fast I do 5 miles uphill.
Mm-hmm.
Every day, timed it.
Was that something big with your trainer, with Customato?
No, it was with me.
With you?
He didn't believe in running. He said, why don't you clean your room? You're running out there all day, you should clean your room. He has believed you go in the ring, you box all day,
yeah.
Box all day. Because that's what you're doing. You're going to be running out in the track. He said, you're not in a track meet. You're out there running all day, wasting your time. You could have been there cleaning your room or something. God, this guy's
that's
nuts.
Funny. Boxing, that's because even back then, it's so old school.
I just like the whole thing, the running and everything that goes along with being a fighter.
I mean,
without that, by fighting is whack. The training, what's the perseverance, the struggle, that's what it's all about.
Yeah, it's the best feeling in the world to get something like that done, too.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Once you win the morning, you win the day.
So what are some of the other things that you tracked when you were training, other than maybe the minute miles, like calories?
How many punches I thrown.
You did?
Yeah.
How did you guys track how many punches you threw?
Well, they count as many they can, else they film it, then they count it when they film them.
So they would have somebody filming, sparring, and bag work, and counting punches?
Yes.
Wow. Do you remember the numbers from back then? How many punches you throw maybe per round or anything like that?
No.
Yeah.
But when I was training for my last fight, I threw more.
Wow.
Yeah.
The last fight with Roy?
Yes. Yes.
Wow. So this idea of you versus you that we were talking about, you were taking that into every run. Trying to be better
Absolutely.
Than that last one.
Yeah, always training, always with some egocentric, I gotta beat this record, I gotta beat this, I beat this, even to like hurt myself.
Yeah.
And that's just, that's the good part of the ego.
Mm-hmm.
You know, pushing you to your highest potential.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes when you when you struggle, your ego say, hey, stop, because your ego don't want to push yourself, don't want to exert yourself. Yeah. But you have to suppress your ego and continue to move. Mm-hmm. You think the ego wants you to do 10, 20 miles, he feels that too. He don't want to deal with that stuff.
Yeah, it's funny. It's a lot of people have negative connotations when it comes to the idea of the ego, but in a lot of ways it has very positive effects on you.
You just have to take everything that's good from it and throw the rest of the stuff in the garbage where it belongs. Mm-hmm. That's just what life is about.
Yeah, absolutely.
In my perspective, I guess.
Yeah. All right, amazing. That's really cool. So another thing I wanted to talk to you about, one of the things you see a lot with Fight Camp, the tens of thousands of users we have, is a lot of them are parents. And once they get the bag in the house with the content and the trackers, it becomes the kind of things where, like, first of all, they're setting good habits for their kids because their kids are watching them work out. And then their kids are like, I want to hit the bag. Mm-hmm. I want to work out. Cassie, do you have that video? I'd love to show Mike what I'm talking about here. So here's a little kid doing one of my workouts, Mike. It's the cutest thing ever. So he's following literally everything I'm doing, learning how to sweat, learning how to get that feeling. And obviously this is a little guy, right? But as they get up in age and they get a little bit more coordination, some of our kids have even gone on to compete in amateur fights and stuff like that. Cassie, you want to grab that?
There's no exercise like this.
Yeah.
There's nothing like this. Yeah. Constantly punching. This, you know, humans are not made to do this. You know, we're not developed to fight. Our hands are too developed to break. That's why they started wearing gloves. Cause every time, first round, boom, first punch, break your hand.
Yeah.
And this is something that human beings discovered, because we're not built for it. You know, if we were, we wouldn't have had to have wraps or anything. Our hands are too brittle to be slamming against anything of any substance. So this is human beings' really sick imagination of really taking the anger out.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say, because we're, you know, everything you say makes sense, right? But for some reason, even though people aren't made for it, they're drawn to it.
That's interesting, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
You know why? Because I don't really want to say it on television, but this is a narcotics. You know, you have to know that.
Yeah.
Hitting the ball, running, all that stuff, that's a natural high. Mm-hmm. They can't stop. People got their bones, everything, mystic, and they still run out there running. It's, without it, they're miserable.
Mm-hmm. This one right here is like that. She's up every morning running, and then she's working out 14 more times.
There's nothing like outside running, huh? There's nothing like it.
Yeah. What do you think about it? It's that feeling that you get after you complete a hard workout, right?
It's euphoric. That's the word I'm looking for. It's really euphoric. Mm-hmm. You have to come down. Maybe you can't stop. You got to keep moving to come down. Mm-hmm. You know?
You know, a lot of people, they have different ways to get. It's almost like a high, like you said, a narcotic. People always say that, like the runner's high, right? But what we found
is, that's the runner's high. They got something called the, oh, yeah, I can imagine, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't hear anything. It's not something you don't hear anything but yourself breathing.
Yep. It's the best feeling in the world. And then what we found with a lot of our members, that, hitting the bag, that aggression is even another level of that runner's high, because maybe they're at work all day and they're frustrated and they can take it out on the bag. Yeah.
I believe that. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Do you ever feel frustrated and doing a workout or something like that, or hitting the bag makes you feel better?
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah.
All the time.
Yeah.
Sometimes I hit the bag through this. I look at it and a side of it, wow, if I punch somebody in their face at this moment, maybe this would happen. Somebody I really don't like at this moment. You know, some people you have to fucking kick their ass, you know. Mm-hmm. You just don't care how much of a Buddha you want to be or whatever. Some people need the ass kicked. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what it is. I'm sure I wish I didn't say that, but.
No, that's how I feel about Dave.
You just can't, man. Somebody has to do that.
I love Dave. Dave's the best.
That's how he feels about me.
Yeah.
He's awesome. Yeah. Dave's awesome. When we talk about, you know, that kid watching their parents and then doing the workouts, is that something that you encourage your kids, this idea of like being
absolutely
physically fit?
Absolutely. My daughter has to understand she's a tennis player, and she has to know playing tennis is a running game, and you have to build your metabolism, build your heart up real fast, and this is the best thing for it.
Do you think that she got a lot of these good habits from you, from watching you working out and competing?
She knows. Sometimes she thinks she knows too much, and then I have to explain to her, this is why this happened, because you didn't listen. But she's a good student.
Yeah.
You know, it's tough listening to your parents. I know it's complicated.
Yeah.
So I make it like we fight back and forth where she can feel comfortable and won't have to be, you know, she can say what she wants.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, kids are always watching us, right?
Absolutely.
I remember I used to watch my mother. She used to do the Richard Simmons.
He's a badass. Man. Richard Simmons is bad. Listen, I'm watching this tape or something, and somebody had made fun of him. He was walking, somebody had made fun of him, and he gets to boom!
Oh, yeah?
Richard Simmons was tough, man.
Really? You ever met him?
No, but I have the biggest, most respect for that brother.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. He really wanted to help the world, make sure everybody stays slim and healthy and everything. You know?
Yeah.
That's a real, like I said, nothing impossible for somebody who tried. What he did was something that you can never think. Now, that's an ego you can't even imagine. He believed it was his job to get everybody in the whole planet in shape.
Unbelievable.
Woo! No, seriously, that's what he believed. 100%. That was his journey.
Yeah.
And that's beautiful, yeah. No, I know him. Never forget him, huh? Never forget that man.
Yeah, yeah. And he was somebody who wasn't scared. He wasn't scared to be himself.
Let's do it. Hey, yeah. All right. Yeah. All right. Bring it down.
Mike, we got to get you up on stage leading everybody through workouts soon with Mike. You know?
All right. We got it.
Absolutely. That's hilarious. So that's really cool. And I had read about your daughter. She's like a tennis star.
Yeah, she's up and coming.
Yeah. Did you teach her any of these workout things that had made her better, how to run?
Absolutely. I told her that in tennis, you're playing a running game. You need to get in track and field. That's what I did. I was on the track and field running sprints all day for an hour. And she's starting to do. She's playing soccer now. Mm-hmm. But she just needs to keep that constant running, moving, spreading, boom, constant. For an hour, it's moving fast. Mm-hmm. Constantly keep the heart pumping.
Yeah. Yeah. That's really cool. Do any of your kids hit the fight camp bag for a workout ever in the garage?
No. I do, and my daughter. We don't do the hit.
Oh, cool. So you and your daughter will hit the fight camp bag?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. What do you guys do on it?
I just time a minute, give me a minute, mm-hmm. stop, yeah. give me 20 second rest, boom, give me another minute.
Yeah.
Then I push the minute up to a minute and a half.
Okay.
And she's up to 2 minutes, then we get stopped.
That's cool.
She's getting it.
Similar to what we were talking about back with those runs, where it was always about, okay, you have a minute down, let's do the minute and a half.
It's just like, that's how the world runs. That's why it's better now than it was 1,000 years ago. Yeah. You know, that's what pigeons, we race our pigeons. Mm-hmm. And whoever gets there quickest win. And it's just, they know that they're racing it for time. They know they have to get there at that time. They know they're racing. Mm-hmm. And they go there, get them, click them, they're the fastest bird.
The pigeons.
Yeah.
Really?
Racing pigeons. They cost them, to buy a championship racing pigeon probably costs you $2 million.
Really?
Yeah.
For how many pigeons?
One.
For one pigeon?
I don't look it up.
Really?
The most expensive pigeon ever. Watch, you'll see it.
Yeah, that's awesome. I didn't know that.
Homing pigeons, they don't fool around.
The champion pigeons.
Though. Yeah, the champions, the world champions.
And they're just bred like that over the years, and that's why they're the best?
Yeah. Since the goddamn Crusades.
Yeah. That's interesting. It's funny, I was watching something.
The Queen of England has pigeons, too, she puts in the race as well.
Really? Still?
All the royal families do that. I think it's a betting game, a sporting game.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, I knew that about you, that you had pigeons that you had kept. I didn't know that you raced them, though.
I've raced them as well.
It's really cool. When I was a kid, I grew up in the projects in Cambridge, in Boston. And we used to catch pigeons and let them go, of course. We used to set up a little...
Those are street pigeons.
Yes, yeah, right? Those are the tough ones.
You're talking about pedigrees.
We would set up like a milk crate with a stick and tie a string around it, put the bread, boom, throw it out, and let them go.
See, a pedigree pigeon would never go for that. Let's
he's dead. Yeah, that's hilarious. Mike's pigeons would just look at me like, come on, fool.
Well, they wouldn't even stop me.
That's hilarious. I love it.
Oh, yeah. And with your daughter, when you do the boxing workouts on the Fight Camp bag, can she punch?
Yes. She has good leverage. That's why she hits the ball like a savage.
How old is she?
She's 13th on Christmas Day. She became 13.
Amazing. Yeah. Yeah. Well, congratulations. You must be proud.
I'm just happy that she's doing something that she likes.
That she loves, yeah.
She looks good. She stays lean and mean. Mm-hmm. I'm just happy. I'm proud of her.
Absolutely, yeah. Something.
You
that
know, most young girls, they look at food as an outtake in life sometimes. You know, it's comfortable. So I'm glad she didn't reach that that level yet in life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that she's doing something positive.
That she likes. Yeah. That she likes.
That's really cool. That could potentially even like take her to college and everything.
Oh, she wants to go to professional. She wants to turn pro next year for when she's 15.
Amazing. Like Osaka.
Yeah, that's what she wants. Yeah. That's her dream.
Yeah, well, she's definitely got the right role models. That's for sure.
Yeah, she trained with Venus Camp before.
I'm talking about you.
Well, I'm okay, but it's good for her to see her peers.
Yeah, it is.
We'll see other women look good and do well.
Yeah, absolutely.
She has to understand she's just as equal, you know.
Really? That's interesting that you say that. So that's something that you talk to her about, is that confidence then?
Yeah. And I don't know. Do I want her to be alpha? I don't know. I want her to be her. You know what I mean? But I don't want her to just... She has to know the power of the word no. And all those, you know, just life lessons and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, what I heard from you there a little bit, tell me if I'm wrong, was a little bit of that athlete confidence. Like, I want her to know that nobody's better than her.
Well, exactly. But this, you always have to, this is interesting when you talk about, when sports, I was taught by my trainer, you always got to be careful about the way you fight your fights, because the way you fight your fights will be the way you live your life. So she has to always be careful the way she plays tennis. She has to always be controlled. Never lose control. Because if they could break you there, it can break you in life. And that's how I look at life. This is life I'm fighting. It's the same things, the mistakes I'm going to make in life, I'm going to make in here, and the same things are going to happen. I'm going to lose. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to die, you know.
That's interesting, because when I think of that athletic competitive edge, especially in terms of like a fighter, you almost think of that fighter that is a little bit out of control but dominant for that reason. But to you, do you look at that as like a negative, and you think a fighter is
no
different?
No great fighter is out of control. He can give the perception as if he's out of control, but no great fighter, no great athlete is out of control. That's just the perception he gives. It's normally an illusion.
And when it's not an illusion, they're probably in trouble.
Actually, you know, that's, some people need the way to act that way, to perform the way they need to perform. You know, I have to be the mean guy, in order for me to perform the way I perform. Because I just have to have that aura of just, I don't know, malevolence, whatever it is, that just dark aura when I fight.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. And something you said a little bit ago that I wanted to just quickly circle back to is you almost made a connection between this concept of you versus you, the way you were from one run to the next where you wanted to beat that, as being almost tied to the way people have grown, humanity's grown over time. Is it because you feel that constant strive and that battle with the ego to be better is pushed off?
Well, I think this is really, we're talking about the ego. Listen, we're living in a time now where normally a guy 50 years old, he would never be able to perform the way 50-year-olds and 60-year-olds are performing now. We have anti-aging gimmicks and medicine that can just take us back to our 20s, and we're 50. So we live in a different time. We're almost the bionic man era, you know?
Yeah. You looked like the bionic man when you asked why. I couldn't believe the way you moved.
Oh, man. These doctors can do anything to you. this is Frankenstein stuff, man.
Yeah, I couldn't believe how explosive you still were when you were punching. Yeah, it's amazing. It must feel good to be able to still perform like that.
It's good exercise.
Yeah. Awesome. Oh, so, just moving on. You said that one of your main reasons for investing in Fight Camp was that you feel like there's millions and millions of people that are just like you. And you said for that reason, that's why I know people are going to gravitate towards
100%. Listen, even if they have it in their bag, they don't see. You look at, hey, I'm working out today. You get upset with your wife or something, I'm working out today. You know, that's how my mind works. It's just, I have too much energy. I want to work out, hit the bag today.
Yeah.
You know, I just, I can't stand still sometimes.
Yeah, yeah. Obviously, when you say like people just like, you don't mean top athletes, you can be a heavyweight champion, you mean they struggle with some of the same things.
Exactly, 100%. Emotion relieves tension, and people don't know how to relieve their tension.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they panic instead of release it like in a bag or go for a walk or something.
Yeah. And you feel boxing is a great way to relieve tension.
It's the only way. You're not really, but this is, there's nothing better than that. The act is, when you do it, it's how you feel.
Mm-hmm.
You feel like you're euphoric on that other level.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why it's so successful.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be successful if it wasn't what it was said to be.
Yeah.
The best.
Yeah. Absolutely. We have some kickboxing stuff now, too. We added that recently. You ever try that?
Never.
No, I tried. I embarrass myself when I try to throw the kicks, right, Griff? I tried.
What are you doing, right?
but speaking of the kicks and the kickboxing, I don't even know if we mentioned this to you, but when you did invest in that last round, we had some others that invested too, like George St. Pierre. Mm-hmm. You know George St. Pierre?
Yes, the champ.
The champ, yeah. Francis Ngannou, the heavyweight.
Oh, that's he's the champ now too.
You know Usher, the singer?
Yeah.
The recording artist? Yeah. So he invested as well.
Oh, he made a great move. He's really athletic as well. He likes to keep in shape. When we played Sugar Ray Robinson, Sugar Ray Leonard.
Yeah, Sugar Ray Leonard. Hands of Stone.
Yeah.
Right?
That was good. Yeah,
yeah,
I like that.
That was an awesome movie.
He really played the whole psychology game, just like Ray Leonard. Hey, I'm too smart for that. He's just brilliant.
Yeah. You thought Usher did a good job in that movie.
I thought he did a great job, yeah.
He can box. I delivered a fight camp to his house. And one of our trainers, Flowmaster, was Usher's trainer. Mm-hmm. He taught him how to kickbox and how to box. So we brought it there, and he made Usher go through a workout. And I was surprised. Usher can throw some punches. Yeah.
That's really interesting. Maybe we get some celebrity boxing.
That'd be cool. Yeah. It'd be cool to even have you guys all doing something together, just some fitness stuff.
Yeah.
It'd be fun.
Running sprints or something.
That'd be amazing, yeah.
When I was younger, everything was working out. My whole life, if we're shooting dice, we're shooting for push-ups, sit-ups. And it's just everything was working out. Hey, I bet you I could beat you right from here to here for 30,000. I could do this and that. Everything we did was consistent about working out. I bet you I could beat you up the stairs. It's just, that's what my whole life was.
Competing.
Yeah.
You think you're still doing it?
I got the best weed in the world. I got the best fight camp in the world. Yeah, I think I am.
Absolutely. I love that. We're taking over with Fight Camp. The number one at-home fitness solution by far, easily, no problem. That's why Mike Tyson's working with us.
Exactly.
So this is named after a fighter's fight camp. What happens in a fighter's fight camp? What are some of the pillars of a fight camp?
You have to live the lifestyle of a fighter. Mm-hmm. You have to... isolation. That's what people really don't really dig. When you're 100 miles away from New York City and you're near the woods and you hear coyotes and all that crap, it's not fun then. Mm-hmm. But that's discipline. Discipline is doing what you hate to do, but doing it like you love it.
What was that?
Discipline is doing what you hate to do, but doing it like you love it.
I love that quote.
Yeah, and that's what you have to do to be the best.
Yeah.
If you have any problem, if you had a problem, it's just because. Yes, you don't even have to, just because you eat too much ice cream, I don't want to eat it no more. No, that's what this one is. Just something, take something out of your life or put something in your life that's going to improve you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what discipline is.
Yeah.
I'm not going to eat ice cream for 6 months. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to throw it out of my life, but I'm just going to take 6 months off.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's what discipline is. Not just taking things away from you, but letting you know you can live without anything.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need anything.
That diet discipline is one of the hardest too. Like you talk about the ice cream.
Oh yeah, but it's good when you overcome that. You can't. No one can change anything. You can't change with this unless you change yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we think this is going to change the world. But more people are going to keep buying this, and we gotta grow with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, we have to grow with it.
Yeah.
You can't make this just one good idea and just. Take on all over the world, we have to grow with it.
Yeah. Yeah, speaking of growing with it, that's one of the things. So recently, we added more content, different content to the Fight Camp platform. So one of the things that we added on top of the bag workouts is strength and conditioning. Yeah, was strength and conditioning a part of your training camps coming up?
Yes, later in my boxing career, I started using weights and doing a lot of benching and stuff and doing sprints.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that, a lot of abs?
A lot of abs, everything. It was just a beautiful time in life.
What would you do for abs?
What we do, we have throw the medicine ball back and forth, the medicine ball, this, and then I go home and I'll do 2,500 on my thing. Under my bed, on my bench, mm-hmm. and I would do 2,500 then.
So with one of your fight camps...
You know, that's why all my back was infused and everything because I did so many sit-ups.
It was the sit-ups, huh? Yeah. Overdoing it a little bit. Yeah, because you do so much core. It's what Cassie teaches me. It starts to pull those muscles forward and hurt your back.
It paralyzes you. It gives you sciatica, right? Oh, you know what sciatica is?
Mm-hmm.
Do you?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Yeah.
You think you're tough. Let's get some sciatica. Ah, you can't move.
You fall to the ground.
Somebody got to help you. Yeah. To the bathroom is embarrassing, right? Your wife got to help you. it's really humbling.
That's why one of the very important things that we did when we started adding core work in, and this is something that Cassie was like decades in training brought to us, was the concept of not just the core shred workouts, mm-hmm. which we do have for the abs, but also the stabilization. So we do a lot of core stabilization in the abs.
See, that's new. Know. People never did it. People just beat the hell out of their back to get the abs, you know?
Mm-hmm. It's because boxing's old school.
Yeah, old school for real.
Sounds like even
it's not about working hard, it's about working smarter now.
That's a great quote.
See, I thought you made it up.
Yeah,
but that's true. It's not about harder, smarter.
I think it is, yeah. Like recovery is a big thing that you never heard that even 10, 15 years ago.
Yeah, we got to stop running on these hard, solid foundations. You know, they're no good for our legs.
How did you mix rest into your training camps?
Excuse me?
Like rest, how important was that in your training camps?
I don't know, it wasn't that important for me.
No?
No.
Yeah, it wasn't like somebody...
I can't sleep.
No?
I can't sleep before a fight camp. I hit the mitts all night.
All night. So...
The trainer would say, go to bed, chill out, no, I gotta hit the mitts.
Yeah. You said something earlier that was really interesting to me where there's a lot of metaphors in boxing that relate to, like, even if you're not a fighter, it, you know, relates back. And one of the things you said is, like, you know, training camp's all about isolation, right? And most people can't go to the Catskills and have a camp, but they can cut things out of their life that are affecting them negatively. They can stop going to the club on the weekends and doing things like that if they want to accomplish their goals. So.
Well, listen, there's no weekend club. Well, you're going to be a weekend warrior. You're going to train for 5 days and 2 days. You're going to party and fuck a bunch of brothers. No, it's not going to work if you want to be a world champion. Get out. You want to be an amateur champ? Maybe. You can't even be an amateur champ doing that. Mm-hmm. You got to dedicate your whole life, every inch in your life that you ever could think of into that. Because you're going to need it to survive. Yeah. Everything you have.
Yeah. And do you think that some of that same mindset applies to people just looking to hit fitness goals?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I looked at guys and I said, I want my body to look like that. I want that kind of body. Everybody inspires everybody, knowing or not. Mm-hmm.
This is the time of the year, it's January, where people, they start to like set these goals for themselves fitness-wise, these New Year's resolutions, and people, they set these really lofty goals. They're like, January 1st, I'm gonna start. And then the statistics show that by the third week in January, 80% of those people completely abandon this dream that they had, this vision. You have any advice for these people right now?
Just live your life one day at a time, the moment. Just get through that day. Mm-hmm. And once, almost like, hey, you get through the day, then it's all great. Then wait for the next day. You know, you can have goals, but just get through the day first. Mm. You know, just get through the day.
So, yeah, with like a fitness regimen, you think just take it one day at a time, don't think about the end game.
No, you think this is what I have to do. It's whatever happens in my life, this has to be done at this particular time. Mm-hmm. If that's just how, but they can't start without that being done.
Yeah.
It's just how I live my life. And if I don't get that done, I won't eat that day.
Okay. So if somebody came up to you, like somebody you care about, Mike, you know, I'm overweight. The doctor said I need to cut some things out of my life. I need to get back in shape. What advice would you give? What would you tell them day one to start doing?
Oh, just stop all sugary drinks, sugar, juices, and all that stuff. Stick with the water, the tea, mostly warm water, because warm water burns fat. cold water adds to fat. Yeah. And so I would just tell them eat everything that's some fat, like seafood, almost seafood is fat burning. Mm-hmm. So I would tell them to eat all fat burning food, use certain natural medicines like Bermadine and stuff that's on the market. Mm-hmm. Everything that burns the fat, eats the fat, read about it. Doing some examinations about the issues of it.
Yeah.
You know, investigation is the best way to do it.
Yeah.
Anything you want to do, you can find out from investigating mm-hmm. on the YouTube, whatever we have now, you know.
Yeah. And make sure to subscribe to his YouTube channel as well, Mike Tyson's YouTube channel.
Oh, my YouTube is crazy.
That's amazing. Yeah, it's awesome. So you said something that was interesting to me too when you talked about the ice cream, where it's like, I think a lot of people, they think, well, now I'm going to be on a diet, so that means I get nothing of what I like. And the way you proposed, it was like, don't think of it like you're throwing this away forever.
No, it's a moment in my life. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not throwing your life away. This is just putting something aside to accomplish your goal. You can go back to your cigarettes after that, but we have a goal to accomplish. Mm-hmm. You know, I know you don't. That's just what you do. Some people just have some goals. Mm-hmm. I'm a goal-oriented. I always want to have a goal, no matter what it is. Mm-hmm. I walk around the block more than I did yesterday. I just have to have a goal. But I had a goal, I sit around the house, and then I just eat too much. Mm-hmm. You know, so I just always have goals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you got to have that, like, conqueror mindset.
I just left from doing, I don't know, what was that, interview for my cannabis. Selling cannabis. Now I come from that to selling fight camps.
Yeah. Wow.
Well, whatever goal I set to establish, it's going to be delusional. And in order for me to accomplish that goal, I have to become that character and believe that I'm that character, and that character is going to exist, and I'm going to be that character, and that's how that really happens. Mm-hmm. Well, it did for me, of course. Mm-hmm. You know, it's me.
Just projecting forward into the future.
Absolutely. Wanting to be up more than anybody wants you to be down. Mm-hmm. You know, you're nothing without your haters or enemies. Even though they beat you better, you're nothing without them. Without them, you're average.
Mm-hmm. How important is confidence to that?
I don't know. I believe, like I said before, confidence breeds success. Yeah. Success breeds confidence. Confidence applied properly would supersede a genius. There's nothing in the world like confidence. Yeah. Nothing.
So a lot of these people trying to hit these fitness goals in the new year, you think it's more about discipline than anything?
Oh, absolutely discipline. Like on Thanksgiving, you don't know what a black house looks like in fact. Oh, man, Thanksgiving, you see the sweet potato, there's cakes here, pies here, juice here. It's everything there. And you have to say, well, I'm not going to eat this. I want to eat this. I'm not going to eat this. Cause no, I'm not going to eat that. But most of the stuff, my mother-in-law is smart. A lot of it's vegan, so she realized after a couple of Thanksgivings, I didn't eat anything, so she made most of it vegan.
Yeah. You know what's horrible for me? When I was younger, our New England championships, for 3 years in a row, I was in the final of the New England championships, and it was the day after Thanksgiving.
What championship for what?
For boxing.
Really?
Yeah. And it was the day after Thanksgiving, so I had to make weight the day after Thanksgiving. So every Thanksgiving, I'm like, I'm going to be locked in my room. Everybody leave me alone.
I don't know. Food is an interesting subject. It's like, it's under FDA, it's a narcotic, right? It's just.
It is.
It can imprison you. You know, it imprisoned me before.
Yeah. So I was able to ask the Fight Camp community, tens of thousands of people all throughout the US, if you could ask Mike Tyson one question, what would it be? And I cut out all the BS, like, can you ask him if you can give me a dollar? He's like, shut up.
I like that guy.
Ask Mike if you give me a dollar. They were putting their Venmo in the comments and all that.
I love this. Give me a dollar, nigga.
Yeah. But
That's an inside joke.
You know how it is though, when you go home, you have to see people you grew up with back in the day. So, Mike, you've been killing it. I love the podcast. I gotta go.
Break me up.
But to the question that stood out the most, that I actually would love to ask you, is people are like, why don't you have Mike Tyson in front of you? Ask him how to generate punching power. What are the mechanics? What does he do?
It's all leverage.
Yeah?
Yeah, leverage.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you mean by leverage? Would you be able to show me? Would that be possible?
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you want to finish up here and then we'll go there, or do you want to do it right now?
I'm pretty much finished up with the questions. The other thing they asked about, everyone says it's pretty obvious that Mike had the best head movement in heavyweight boxing history.
I don't know about all that.
Well, one of the best head movement.
Maybe one of the best.
I think the best head movement. And people are wondering if they get a little demo on what they should be doing, moving their head.
Well, it's not as easy as it looks. Like, people look at this stuff and they think, well, just going in like this, it comes with hours and hours of training, doing this, moving, slipping, until it becomes like part of your life.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Are there any considerations when you're moving your head, like you're trying to get your head out of the center line?
No, well, you want to get out the center, but the objective for him to throw the punch before you can counter. Like, if he throws the punch here, you come here, you go to here, right. And you're still outside.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes sense. So you want them to miss, and when they miss, that's your opportunity.
Absolutely. Sometimes you can punch while he's punching. You can throw boom at the same time. As he punches, boom, and you go down.
Absolutely.
It's all about moving after you punch. As soon as you punch, you're gone. Whatever it is, boom, side, whatever it is, you have to go.
I love that foot movement. Is that something that Casamato taught you?
Yeah, twisting.
Twisting is what it's called. So it's not even a pivot. It's almost like a jump step.
No, it's just sound. No. Just what we do. Slip, whip,
yep.
And then you whip your butt.
And then when you do that, you have somebody who is here. You shift on them. They're still looking this way. You're right here.
It's right here.
Yeah.
Sleep.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
That's what boxing is about. The punches that knock you out, the punches you don't actually see.
Yeah. Yeah, I've heard that actually. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense too. Because your brain gets a jolt. Yeah, and your brain gets conditioned, I think, to take punishment as you learn how to box. Like, the more you're sparring, if you see it coming, your brain can prepare, but if you don't see it.
Like, some guys get knocked out early in their career, and then something happens, and they just keep winning all the time. Then they become champion. And it's just from that experience changed their whole life. Mm-hmm. They're not afraid to get hit anymore. They're not afraid to make mistakes, mm-hmm. take chances.
Yeah. Well, thank you for that, Mike. I appreciate that. Look, I boxed since I was a little kid, but I can teach some fitness people how to box, but there's going to be nothing like having Mike Tyson, right? This knowledge passed down.
I think we should do that before.
It'd be awesome.
All of it's this. This is all twisting for like golf. When you this, everything's there.
That's how you get the power?
Yeah.
What is it that you're doing there? You're really shifting your weight,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's just balance.
Yeah. You know what I noticed about your punches? A lot of times people will teach you want to punch and retract. But with you, every punch is a knockout punch where you
I go with it. Everything's like boom. Yeah. I go through with it. Boom.
Every punch you throw like that.
Yeah.
Interesting. You think that was one of your keys to having a lot of power?
I'm going through them. My objective is to go through them.
Yeah. It's so funny. Just for me, coming up in the amateur system, everything's about, get that quick point. Ha! Then you're done.
In the amateurs, boom, I drop you. You get up and go pop, pop. Your head.
And you win. Yeah. Yeah. Is that one of Customato's philosophies? Did he teach you how to power punch? Or was that something that came natural?
Yeah, so you have to be ferocious. Fans want to see that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Was Floyd Patterson, was he a power puncher?
He had a couple of knockouts. He was fast.
Yeah, he's fast. But it wasn't this, you were more of a power puncher naturally. Yeah. Yeah. He moved his head well, though.
Really fast.
Yeah.
But then he was small for that time.
Very.
Yeah, 187 pounds.
Crazy. Yeah, the heavyweights weren't that big.
It's just weird how different generations get bigger and bigger. And I don't know about better, but we get bigger.
Tyson Fury.
Monster, right?
Wow, huh? And the way he moves? Still?
He's a strange dude, right? Yeah. He's a strange guy.
Yeah, I think he's like a spirit brother to you. He's named after you.
He's
crazy.
He's nuts, too.
Yeah, he is, right? I love him.
Oh, he really is.
All right, so there you have it. I hope you enjoyed that. We have Mike Tyson in studio, one of the greatest of all time. And of course, Fight Camp investor, talking about all things confidence, Fight Camp, fitness, and all his philosophies towards training. If you like that content, hit the like button and don't forget to subscribe for more content like that. Now I'm gonna go practice that move he was showing us.